to welcome all of you and thank you for coming out for our November Biophilia meetup. My name is Sarah States. I'm the research manager here in the Department of Science, Education, and Research. For those of you who are new, this is our monthly speaker series, and it happens on the first Thursday of every month. And the goal of this is not only to learn something new about a biophilia-related topic, but to discuss and share ideas. And so tonight, the format is going to be a little bit different. I'll give an introduction to our presenters, and Susan Spangler will lead us in a brief guided meditation. And then Nicole Capazzi, director of the Boxheart Gallery, will lead a Q&A session with our artists, and then we'll have time for discussion as well. So our other biophilia-related event, our monthly film series, is coming up on November 18th. That's the third Friday of the month. And this month, we're showing The Last Crop, and we'll have the director, Chuck Schultz, here. And this is actually the first showing of this film in the Pittsburgh area. And as always, attendance is free with admission, and please pick up tickets in the Welcome Center. I also want to mention that we are sending out a survey to the Biophilia mailing list. We would like to get an idea from you what speakers you like, what you don't like, what topics you'd like to hear more about. So look for that in the next week or so, and share your thoughts with us. So tonight we welcome artists Ashley Cecil and Deirdre Murphy. Augustina Droz could not attend, unfortunately. Ashley and Deirdre will discuss how the cultural partnerships they developed with Powdermill Nature Reserve and the Carnegie Museum of Natural History led to important artist residencies that guided the process of their artistic creations. Ashley spent 2015 partnering with the Carnegie Museum of Natural History, the National Aviary, and Phipps Conservatory to complete a self-directed residency creating artwork from specimens, exhibits, and florals. Her efforts call attention to how a museum's collection traces the origins and relationships of varying species. This April, Deirdre completed a residency at Powdermill Nature Reserve, exploring long-term data of juxtaposed migratory birds. Luke DeGroote, avian research coordinator at Powdermill, provided Deirdre with data from the bird banding station that she used to visually represent what subtle patterns and changes tell us about our relationship to nature and each other. Emergent Patterns brings together the remarkable contemporary artwork of Pittsburgh-based Ashley Cecil, Philadelphia-based Deirdre Murphy, and Buffalo-based Augustina Droz. Gathering an exquisite collection of paintings, the exhibition celebrates wise conservation, specifically the Migratory Bird Treaty Act, bringing into focus a generative and incisive dialogue regarding the patterns found in collective behavior and the significance of chance observations through innovative forms of expression. Susan?
Hi, so for those of you who are new, these few moments are really just an opportunity for us to all fully arrive and to give ourselves full permission to just be here. Had a lot happen in our days of responding to the demands of the day, so here you get to just leave that all behind. So if we can begin with just having your feet on the floor, feeling the ground under you, supporting you, and your hands can just rest loosely in your laps in whatever way feels comfortable for you. And if you feel comfortable closing your eyes, you can close your eyes. If not, just let the gaze be downward and soft, relaxed. You might begin simply with recognizing whatever you're arriving with, whatever feelings, sensations, particularly whatever you notice in the body. And meeting whatever you find, whether it's pleasant or unpleasant, tight or loose, simply meeting whatever you find with awareness. Letting it be, just however it is. soles of the feet on the earth. The weight of your body in the chair. Finding a place where you can feel the body breathing. Maybe the belly, the abdomen, the back of the throat, the nostrils. And just let awareness rest, let your mind rest on the feeling of the body breathing for a few breaths. Resting on the wave of the breath flowing in and dissolving out with the out breath. And when you hear the sound of the bell, you might enjoy following the sound of the bell into silence. And then gently lifting your gaze or opening your eyes and letting yourself receive the presentation for the evening.
My name is Nicole Capozzi. I'm the owner and director of Box Art Gallery in Bloomfield, and I'm quite honored to have the opportunity to introduce you today to artists Ashley Cecil and Deirdre Murphy. In addition to the satellite exhibit of Emergent Patterns, which the Center for Sustainable Landscapes has been so wonderful to host outside the store, the main exhibition will be held at our gallery beginning on November 15th. With a reception with these lovely ladies on Saturday, November 19th, and we'll continue through the new year. So we hope you'll be able to make it in to see the exhibit if you get the chance. In the meantime, I would like Deirdre to begin by telling us a little bit more about herself.
Hi, thank you so much for coming out this evening. I really appreciate you sharing your busy Thursday night with us. So I wanted to just show you some of the work that I'm currently creating that is inspired by the idea of migratory birds. And one of the questions that I've had late is how has climate change affected the migratory pattern of raptors and passerine, the songbirds? So I did a residency in 2015 with Hawk Mountain Sanctuary and worked with those scientists about raptors, and then I was lucky enough to work with Powdermill this year. And I live in Philadelphia, so the birds common in Philadelphia are pigeons, right? You're going to see some pigeons in the work as well. So to give you a little bit of background, I am the daughter of a scientist, so I grew up in a lab, kind of like an army brat, but a lab rat. Nobody tested anything on me that way. Growing up with science around me was just so common, you know? I mean, hanging out in a lab and, you know, all the smells and sights. And looking through the electron microscope and things like that were, you know, seeing a centrifuge, all those things were just kind of normal. And so I always knew I wanted to be an artist. And then the idea of a scientist working solo, having this monastic kind of experience of gathering data, observing, making inferences, and then going within to really try and, you know, pose those queries, those questions, is exactly the same methodology of being an artist. And so it's not very, it's not disparate at all. So I came to art making through that route, and then also living abroad. My being a hematologist oncologist, my dad traveled and did research at various institutions. So we lived in Paris and in Manchester, England, in Australia, and then I lived in Japan after that, after high school. And so those kind of just living abroad, always being an outsider, those kind of the ability to kind of look from without or look from within also has really influenced the work greatly.
Hi everybody, thanks again for coming. We're really thrilled about this. My name is Ashley Cecil. I am a local artist based here in Pittsburgh. I have a studio I actually just moved into in Homewood. I'm originally from Louisville, Kentucky, and came to Pittsburgh via London. This is a strange pattern to my travel, and actually came here begrudgingly. I didn't know much about Pittsburgh, so I had all the preconceived notions in my head about what the city was like, only to be really hugely impressed, and now I told my husband that I'm leaving the city with a toe tag, so I love it here. We are not leaving, and my love for the city is part of what I'm going to be talking about tonight, because we feel very invested in the city, these anchor institutions we'll be talking about, and the health and well-being of the environment here. So my background is in commercial illustration and painting. I got my BFA in illustration from the University of Dayton, not too far away. And then I got my master's in art business at Sotheby's in London, because I have, in parallel to working as an artist, I've also done quite a bit of art management, doing fundraising and program management and a few other odds and ends. So that, in a nutshell, is sort of my background.
Well, I'd love to learn more about how each of you feel that biophilia pertains to your artwork and process as visual artists. Ashley, maybe you can begin by talking a little bit about this and also sharing some examples.
So I used to do a great deal of traditional portrait commissions, landscape painting, cityscapes, and more traditional illustration. But that was forever changed by being exposed to naturalist art in England when I lived in London. I spent time in institutions like the Victoria and Albert Museum, actually quite preferable over the more traditional fine art museums, and developed this love of textile design. Fell further in love with William Morris, the arts and crafts movement, but I was still doing more painterly landscapes, still doing portrait commissions. So, but in parallel to that, I started hoarding photos, Victorian wallpaper, samples of wallpaper, fabric samples. I wasn't sure what I was going to do with it, and also was very inspired by even the architecture there. It's everywhere. Wrought iron that is in the shape of these florals and scrolls. You just can't miss it. It's embedded throughout the city of London. But none of that solidified in new work until I came to Pittsburgh. Does anyone remember the Fabergé exhibition at Frick in 2011? Did anybody see that? A few of you. It was wonderful, really great. It was a small exhibit, but I had just been in Pittsburgh for, I think, weeks, and had gone to see this exhibit, and all these small, very intricate objects, and there was this cigarette case, of all things, that had this thistle, and the description was talking about this concept of dangerous beauty. And I don't know what it was about this small thing, but this light bulb went off in my head. I'm like, that's what I'm going to do with that huge folder of pictures that I've been hoarding, the textile patterns. I'm going to start using them as a springboard to talk about or make visualizations of how nature sort of has this viciousness to it, really, when you think about life cycles and how animals compete for territory, so on and so forth, and used a lot of motifs from the arts and crafts movement to start doing that. This is a far more benign example of how that kind of came to be, but and also in this case, this is a commission that I had worked on, but had taken some motifs from a William Morris pattern. So I just completely let go of my past series of work and started focusing exclusively on this blend of hyper-realistic flora and fauna in the foreground that was over top of these flat graphic patterns that were meant to make the foreground look like it was popping off the painting. So I've been working on this for a few years, but now that I've really gotten in deep into these institutions in Pittsburgh that are about natural history and natural sciences, like Deirdre, I've really developed an interest in the past, I'd say, year and a half in how that relates to climate science and conservation. And Sixth Extinction was a really rather depressing and somehow inspirational push in that direction. And now we'll get into this later, but I've spent a great deal of time at places like the Carnegie Museum of Natural History and Phipps developing work around that concept.
That's so interesting. I'm learning so much about it. So let's see. So Winds of Change, this painting was made in 2015, and I was looking at flocking patterns and trying to understand that idea of murmurations and why birds in great numbers flock as they do. Are they how do they move? You know, what is the collective intelligence? Who's the leader? Who follows? How do they change roles? How do they do this like ballet choreographed in the sky? It is that biophilia where finding that kind of connection to, you know, human swarms of people, insect swarms, but just looking at that kind of connection of grouping of multiples. And so what I did in my work was I would take photos, and you have pigeons, right, once again, for Philly. And then I would take the photograph of the pigeon, and then I would just trace point to point and make this like a dot matrix kind of map or point cloud map. And then what would be seen on this far slide were these polygons. So how many triangles came out of it, and what were the shape connections? And as I was doing making these maps, you know, some more intricate and some larger in scale, I was thinking about how with social media, emergent patterns exist, right? So like with Facebook, when one person posts something, then if it's a good post, everybody follows and they repost, you know? And so we think as human beings that we really have the niche, the corner market on social media, when birds have been doing it for a long, long time, and they do it way better than we do. And so this, I just wanted to show you some process about, you know, how I try and take a predictable pattern, such as a flock, and then I'm using, abstract simplified shapes. So similar to Ashley, where I'll take a bird and paint it more representationally, but then all of these polygons represent perhaps a flock of birds, perhaps the wind, movement, molecules, and then arrive at the final composition. Red bud, this one. Thinking about how birds see. And that avian vision is far more sophisticated than the human eye. So I think, and the scientists in the room can tell me if I'm correct or not, but I think for every singular color red that the human eye perceives, what I have read is that a bird perceives up to 50 shades of red. So the bird brain, that notion of a bird brain, completely false.
Yeah. They're
so sophisticated. And then the curvilinear pattern, so inside that looping shape is perhaps my conjecture of, you know, the complexity, the depth of what a bird might see. And then that curvilinear kind of pattern, yes, it could be like an insect swarming around that they might just have for lunch, but it's also based on flocking patterns. So the convection currents of the loft, the warm air, the cool air, how birds actually are able to stay afloat. So those are some ways that I've been able to use scientific data as design aesthetic elements, but also talk about deeper concepts.
The lore of nature and the natural sciences have provided each of you with the opportunities to go into some amazing institutions and do artist residencies. Deirdre, maybe you could begin by telling us about your residency that took place this April at Powdermill Nature Reserve.
Yes. Well, shout out to the Powdermill crew here. Yeah. I have to say thank you so much. As an artist, and actually doing the same kind of self-directed residencies, it just made so much sense to work with scientists in the field. And I was lucky enough to be able to shadow the scientists here tonight and go out and follow their footsteps and to the mist nets and help or watch them really capture the birds out of the mist nets and then weigh them, observe them. And they were kind enough and generous enough to give me this little cabin to stay in. And then you can see I made it into a makeshift studio there. And then this is the beautiful ground. So, we would get up at, I think I was there at 5:36. You were probably there much earlier. And it was just amazing to just be part of the actual research and observation from the science end, and then take note as an artist. And then I was able to, hold the birds and help to help however I was able to. So this is just looking, being able to be so close to the birds and actually interact with them gave my work a profound just insight that I never would have had otherwise. And seeing correlations between those flocking patterns that I showed you earlier and then some of the glass work that the scientists are testing at Powdermill. I believe this one's from Germany. And in their wind tunnel where they were actually releasing the birds down this wind tunnel to see how the bird would react for anti-collision or anti-strike glass. So, looking, and this is like the game where, remember the pickup sticks where you throw the sticks down as a child? So this was created by that notion, that idea of something predictable and becoming a predictable pattern that becomes unpredictable. And I just saw a striking relationship to the geometry in my work. So Powdermill is still inspiring me, and I hope to go back for the fall migratory as well.
My experience working with Pittsburgh institutions that had some focus on natural history or natural sciences started in the summer of 2015. I have a young son, he's 3, and as wonderful as that is, that excludes me from being eligible for many formal residency programs that would hate you if you brought your toddler to the residency program. So I realized that I was staying home or bust. That turned out to be a huge blessing because I really don't think that I would have given Pittsburgh the consideration it deserved if it hadn't been for that constraint. So I started looking close to home to think how I could develop my own residency that fit my work, only to find out it was kind of embarrassing. It hadn't already dawned on me that I didn't need to leave because there was Phipps, the National Aviary, which is only 2 dedicated bird zoos in the country here in Pittsburgh on the north side, and a top 5 natural history museum, which is truly phenomenal. There's no reason to leave. So I did a 2-month-long self-directed residency where every day of that 2 months, I would rotate between those 3 anchor institutions as well as a few florists that hosted me, adding layers to paintings that had elements from each of those places. And it was lovely, obviously a shot of here at Phipps, which was a wonderful place to be. Sparks really flew with staff at the Natural History Museum folks like Matt here, who's in the second row, we're thrilled to have, that works with many of these organizations, helping with collaborative efforts to focus on bird conservation. So of all the organizations that I work with the first residency, it was most obvious that a second iteration could happen for more in-depth at the Carnegie Museum of Natural History. So we fundraised together so that I could spend 6 months, I'm 4 months into a 6 month long residency, working 2 days a week. The difference being this time beyond the duration of it is that I'm not just focusing on visualizing objects in the collections and from exhibits. This go around, I'm actually collaborating with the scientists to get my head around their research projects so that I can visualize those concepts in a way that the end goal is hopefully that museum visitors find this as a means to understand these rather dense scientific concepts to make them more relatable. So this is an example of Nest Watch, which is a collaborative initiative throughout Pittsburgh. It's like a local chapter of it where they have people set up nets in their own backyards to do data collection about these birds that are coming through Allegheny County. So I got a chance to shadow Matt on that, among many other things, to help sort of get the creative juices going. And then I come back to the museum with all that in my head, and then PDFs of research articles the scientists had shared with me, and then of course I had access to the collections, which are truly phenomenal. And it's really been amazing that they have essentially set me loose with a staff badge and just said, don't break anything. So I've been really honored by that. I haven't broken anything yet. What? So I'm gonna get into detail about some of the work that has come as a result, specifically about the bird conservation piece. So I'll save that for later. This is sort of a teaser of what came later and what's going to be in the Box Art Show. But another example, because it hasn't just been related to bird conservation, one other project that is in the works that is a really good example of blending art with natural history is that I'm making, in December, I'm going to start focusing on developing 6 original paintings of nursing mammals inspired by dioramas in the museum on public display, and I'll be creating those paintings in front of museum visitors that can talk with me about my residency. I'm eventually going to make that into a contemporary twist on a wall pattern that will be manufactured as a wall pattern and installed in the breastfeeding area of the museum, award-winning breastfeeding area, I might say. So for those of you who have ever nursed your children, I'm sure you've done it like I have in a public restroom or wherever, but now you're going to have a super swanky place that all the non-lactating people in the world wish they could go into. So this is just one example of what's coming about from this residency. And you can see that in Mother's Day of next spring. So.
Very good.
Do you have specific artwork or a specific work of art that you think best illustrates your vision of biophilia? Ashley, maybe you could show us some examples of that.
So this is the perfect chance to talk about the outcomes from the Bird Safe Pittsburgh inspired work from this current residency. So this is a shot of my museum studio desk. It's a pretty typical view of, we've got some botany specimens on my desk. I have my, well actually this isn't a sketchbook, this is a painting that I used to make burn a silk screen for the finished painting I'm about to show you. And then I've got my sketchbook, I've got a William Morris book up, and then there's also somewhere underneath that a printout of a PDF of some research about this bird window collision issue, which is the second leading human-induced cause of bird fatalities. It's something to the tune of about 1 billion birds die a year in the US from this. So it was something that I really latched onto that had more outcomes than just the original paintings, but about the original paintings, this is another progress shot. So I took that ink painting you saw on the desk and, like I said, burnt a silk screen from it, used that to silk screen the mountain laurel, which is our state flower, and our Pennsylvania keystone. Didn't actually know what that shape was until I had lived here for 3 years. Once I figured that out, decided to use that in this image as well. So I got what turned out to be 6 of the yellow, the silk screen with the keystone and the mountain laurel, and then from that, made each one with a unique painting of six bird species heavily impacted by window collisions, thanks to staff at the museum helping me identify those species. So in work from the specimen collections, this is finished but cropped of that original painting of a wood thrush. And then from that, in addition to having those six original paintings exhibited at Boxhardt at this show coming up just around the corner, I've then been able to use that for other products because I have a background in illustration, and I'm also a crafter. Well, my mother-in-law is in the room, and she definitely outdoes me by all standards, but I eventually used it to develop it into a textile pattern, bringing this full circle back to my love for textile design. And I have this scarf with me if anybody wants to see it after the talk. So we'll be actually selling these, launching them tomorrow, I can't believe, at the Aviary's Wings and Wildlife Art Show. Part of the money that I'm receiving from these sales, I'm actually going to be giving back to Bird Safe Pittsburgh so that they can continue to do their wonderful work of flying birds through the flight tunnel to test effectiveness for these prototypes of bird-friendly window films, rehabilitation of the birds that hit windows but are only stunned. And then one other outcome is a 2x4-foot coloring poster of exact same theme, same bird species, that kids and adults alike, because now that's all the rage, adult coloring books, can work on together. And this actually, the same pattern is going to be installed in Discovery Base Camp of the Carnegie Museum, which is the play area if you're 3 feet and under. So there's going to be a very, very large version of this hung on the wall in time for the holidays for everyone to collectively color in, and then hopefully we can actually capture some people as they're coloring to see if they'd be interested in volunteering for Bird Safe Pittsburgh. So that is my best example of connecting this to humans and our impact on these birds and nature, and how I'm trying to bring it through to fruition with some end product that has a tangible impact.
Again, very impressed by my colleague. Thank you so much. It's wonderful. We only met this evening, so. With my background being heavily in the fine arts end, and I also teach at the University of Pennsylvania in the drawing and painting department. So definitely kind of that cross-disciplinary approach. What I did was look at that idea of how climate change is affecting migration. And I wanted to show a sequencing of time. And so trying to show the mileage that a bird might fly during the spring migration. So over this triptych, each of these are 16 by 16 inches. I took the foliage from around Powdermill, and then would make these shadow paintings because shadows are if you think about like the caves of Lascaux and things like that, the earliest painting was really copying shadows. And so I was thinking, depending on the height of the sun and the season, the shadows change, right? And so at midday, they might be really crisp. As the day goes on, they're going to be more elongated and abstracted. And so that idea of using shadows, chasing shadows, painting shadows to show time. And so that's where the kind of abstracted pattern comes from. And then I literally picked some of the plant life around that the birds would be eating and fattening up for during the springtime, and then painted those on top, so that's a second layer. And then the third layer is actually looking at the data. So this is a satellite map of this happens to be a turkey vulture around Colombia, and so it's I think every hour or so they receive a blip, right, and they're able to track that pattern. So as an artist, I looked at that dot pattern and thought, well, I can incorporate that as a design element, but also hopefully through showing these paintings, then raise awareness about conservation. And then, you know, another correlation came through the work, and this was just through the process of, you know, being out there. The night sky in Pittsburgh is a lot better than the night sky in Philadelphia. Rector, you get incredible night skies. So, you know, the more research I did, finding out that, you know, the songbirds migrate at night and migrate towards the constellations, that led me to this body of work, which is actually on view here. So, you know, Cassiopeia being one of our major constellations that the birds migrate with. And so then that also, the pattern and the star patterns and the flocking patterns and all that, I just saw such similarities between that. And then there's a lot of other artists that do this, right? So Dennis Lewinsky, he teaches at RISD, the Rhode Island School of Art Design, and he's a photographer that's able to really capture this through 600 frames per minute. And I think for time's sake, I'm going to skip over this video, but it'll be on the archive, so you can watch this just on the murmuration, so looking at those patterns. And then the ice patterns, right? How you can see like the geometry that exists. You know, whether it's beneath your feet or above your head.
How do you each see artists as serving and enhancing the natural sciences? Maybe you could talk a little bit more about the intersection of art and science for yourself.
So, bringing it to the public sphere, I think, for me is really important. Showing in a commercial gallery is wonderful, and I am so thrilled to be working with Box Art Gallery and bringing, you know, art to the people that way. But there's also recently trying to reach out to different audiences that might not come to museums and galleries, and so this piece is in progress. This is a sculpture that's going to be based in Dublin, California, and it'll be installed in April of 2017. And so I took those flocking patterns and then made this 25-foot drawing. And my husband, Scott White, who is an amazing sculptor and fabricator, is building this. He is the lead fabricator, and I'm just this cool flunky. But so it's my patterns, and then he's actually making this three-dimensional. So this is going to go in a shopping district. There's an apartment complex of like 365 units. There's an affordable housing complex right there, and then there's a strip mall across the street. There's a BART station and a major highway intersection. So people are migrating every day to San Francisco to work. And so that, I thought, oh, well, let's do something based on migration. How do we integrate, you know, the shopping district and bring art and science together in a way that will bring people together? And so what I did was I researched the orange crown warbler, which is a warbler that's specific to Northern California. And so there'll be a flock of 15 of these on either side. It's a two-faced sculpture, or two panels. And so these orange crown warblers are, they're not on an endangered list, but certainly because of the collision, you know, the window collision, and also just with their habitat in decline, we are concerned about them. And so, you know, this, that live in the apartment will be able to learn about the orange crown warbler, you know, the people that are shopping across the street, and it also is going to provide this kind of meeting place for people to actually just sit and talk and meditate and just be with nature and be with art. On the base of the sculpture will be the constellation patterns of the spring of Northern California sky, and on the other side will be the fall migratory constellation patterns. So at night, it'll be lit from within, and you'll be able to see the constellation pattern at your feet, and hopefully look up on a clear day, clear night, and see it above you. And then during the day, you'll see the male and female of the species. So bringing art to the people has been now a recent interest, and then also working with underprivileged youth in Philadelphia. beautifying their playgrounds, which look like prison yards. No playground equipment, just blacktop, broken glass, hypodermic needles, used condoms. That's not a playground, right? So we're putting in birdhouses with webcams inside, so the kids can actually see these birds feeding and nesting in their classrooms. And then, working with the children with murals, doing flyway maps and things like that on their playground now. And working, so the birds for the William Cramp School, I chose the Baltimore Oriole because those kids in South Kensington, Philly, the average income for a family of four is like $13,000 a year. So it's a severely impoverished neighborhood. And most of the kids are from Puerto Rico. And so with Powdermill's help, I was able to identify the Baltimore Oriole because it flies, it flies through Puerto Rico and then up through the Atlantic Flyway right over Philly. And so it gave the children pause, and they were able to say, you know what, my journey is important, my story is important, my people came this same route, and so it gives them a voice. And so bringing art to the people is certainly my new cause, really. and then this was just last weekend. I did a workshop at Hawk Mountain of drawing from live raptors. And so they brought out a street child that was in a car collision. And she, Miss David is her name. Let's see, where's Miss David? That's my daughter Fiona, who's seven. And it's the first time that she ever drew a live bird. And there's Liam, who's 12. And so you can see Miss David there. And she was a wonderful model. She sat for an hour and a half. And it was amazing. So that was great too. I had students as young as 6 or 7 all the way to almost 80. And some have had no drawing experience, some had years of drawing experience, but we were able to bring conservation and nature science together. So they learned about the bird prior, and then I taught them drawing, and it was all there at the bird sanctuary. So it was a wonderful way to bring art and science to the people.
What a good model.
She's a really good model.
Well, the answer to this question for me is a moving target, but as of right now, the way I'm trying to tackle this is with residency projects. Now that I have through the end of 2016, the pressure is on. So one thing I'm trying to do is use poetry and inserting it into the third floor Hall of Birds in the Carnegie Museum of Natural History. If you're familiar, it is a lovely, long, long hallway filled to the brim with glass cases of stuffed taxidermy, bird taxidermy. Just took this picture of a fellow illustrator this week that was there for a drawing session, so you can kind of get a sense of just a piece of it. So on the left here, you see I've been experimenting in my museum studio using a window paint. Comes off very easily. It's very important for the exhibitions department to know that it's easy to take down. So I've asked the ornithologists, the collection managers at the museum to send me poetry, quotes, or statistics, whatever it is that has been something that's been very inspirational to them, whether it encouraged them to go into the field when they were young budding scientists, or something recently that reinvigorated their interest in staying in their field. And I'm using that to put on these cases. I will be in December. You can come during museum hours and see me installing it. So it will be another way for people to interpret natural history and science, but through the literary arts and the visual arts. And I'll be drawing the birds that the poetry relates to. And if I'm really successful at it, it's gonna tie in nicely with the content of the cases, which is a little bit sporadic, but I'm gonna see how it goes. So instead of something like a more dry, typical education label that is, bird species, something equally kind of just point blank, but adding with that something that a literary artist has provided us that pertains to those bird species, or extinction, or whatever the topic is of the case. So another example is I'm trying to use, this is the illustrator in me, I'm trying to use my work for a tangible product that in some way can provide utility in mitigating this effect that we have on nature. So
this is kind of premature to be talking about it. It's still kind of like pie in the sky that this is actually going to happen, but this is the preparatory sketch for the pattern that I had shown you earlier from the scarf, that we're hoping to make a version of this that is produced as a frosted glass to be tested in the powder mill's flight tunnel to see if it is effective as a window film at mitigating window collisions. So you can see here we have a very unfortunate window kill on the left. You can see these birds see the reflections in the window, so they think they're going to fly straight through it and end up dead or stunned. And right now the kind of solution we have for the most part are polka dots, really, or vertical lines, or something really kind of dry and sterile, hospital grade in my mind, but nothing more aesthetically pleasing and effective. So we're hoping that that's going to be a tangible outcome from that, although again it's still kind of wishful thinking at this point. Hopefully, keep your fingers crossed for me. And then, like Deirdre, part of this is inspiring people and youth to think about, we really need an army of people to tackle this problem of undoing the damage that we've done. And talk about job growth. I mean, if people really consider viable careers in a green economy, we need it. So I'm hoping that I can use visual art activities as a way to teach science lessons that inspire youth to consider becoming an ornithologist or a climate scientist. And I did that this summer. Part of my residency involved me teaching three workshops for summer camp students at the museum. They already had the curriculum built. I just took the topics and developed a art-centric activity that would teach the lesson of the camp through art. And for me, that would have been a game changer as a child if I had someone that tried to teach me chemistry to talk about pigments and paint, or something that somehow related to the thing that my brain really clicked with. But I had none of that, so I kind of had to learn the hard way, and I'm 35, and I'm just now starting to love science. So I'm hoping that I can offer children a way to enjoy and learn science, but through art, which is not a new concept. Bring it back, really. So.
We would like to open it up to the audience for any questions or discussion that they might have for either the artist, Ashley, or Deirdre. Yes.
Yeah, this question is for both of you. Just from my own experience as an artist, I feel like a lot of people kind of have an attitude that art is almost kind of like a second-class field, especially in comparison to science. And I'm just wondering, since both of you have worked as artists like so closely with science, what your experiences with that have been, both like negative or positive. So
that's a good one. Yeah. I have a lot of things to say on that topic, but I'll try to be concise. No one ever trained me in art school how to make a good case for why I deserved grant funding, or even better, to be paid for what I did. So again, I had to really learn it the hard way, and this residency has been wonderful because in a lot of ways, if I want to do a different version of this someplace else or at the museum again, I do have to tell the development department and then their funders why I should stay. Or in 2015, it was, you know, why should she come in 2016? So I've had to think long and hard. Many, many hours spent in my own head thinking about how you translate the visual arts into something that crosses over into mission goals, audience development, education, community outreach, engagement. And I'm getting a lot better at it, actually. Now when I'm in these meetings with senior staff at the museum, I'm no longer sort of tripping over my own language, it's starting to roll off the tongue. And so a tangible example is, you can take the coloring mural, for example, so that's gonna get installed in the museum. Now you've got this captive audience of, I assume is mostly gonna be parents watching their kids, coloring this in, maybe they're helping them. We've included in that a label next to the mural that talks about BirdSafe Pittsburgh and the museum's bird conservation efforts in my residency. And there's going to be a very simple URL in that where someone with a smartphone can go and sign themselves up to be a part of the citizen science program. Now, if I can attribute my coloring mural to having increased or met their registration numbers for the year, quarter, whatever, this is building a case as to why this is a value, you know? So I think about those things from the outset, and that is really important. It's almost impossible to do this if you think of it as an afterthought. You really need to bake it into the program. So I have typically started with, you know, who is the host and what do they need, or who is the funder and what is their funding mission, and thinking about that from day one. It is hard, but it's really possible too, and I think that more artists did it, the public perception of our value would be greatly changed, I hope.
So I come across that issue, I think, on a daily basis as an educator, and, you know, so teaching at University of Pennsylvania, I rarely have fine arts majors or minors. It typically is Wharton Business School or law or computer science. The students come from all different departments. And so I tend to address that question with the students. Like, they say, well, why take art? And I said, well, you know, it's critical thinking. You're going to be able to, since I have so many Wharton MBAs, when you're giving your presentation, your presentation is going to be incredibly compelling. Your colleagues are not going to fall asleep. You know, you're going to actually have that leg up, that advantage, because you're a visual thinker. You can critically think visually, not just verbally, and so I tend to try and get that across to my students that way, that that art is really integral. It's like STEM versus STEAM, right? And I think it just takes really valuing art in our culture, and that's why Nicole and box art, right, is just so important. That I think in American culture we tend to think that art is more of a luxury item, that, you know, oh well, I'll get this poster and I'll, you know, frame that, instead of going to, you know, purchase real art, right, that you make, that we make. And I think that that's something that galleries really help to do, which is to educate, just citizens, that living with art enhances your quality of life, right? It really does. And it does have a value. And so that's kind of how I come across those issues.
Thank you.
Next question.
I appreciate your, but I didn't realize that the loss of, well, the ecosystem in general on Earth is in decline as far as the number of many groups of species, including birds, but I didn't realize what a large amount of an effect of, big glass windows that are clear. My dad worked at Alcosan, the sewage treatment plant on the Ohio, just near the Aviary on the north side, and he was at the pump station, and there's a very, very large open window there that was decades ago. But he would call the Aviary when a bird hit and was knocked unconscious, or even, I guess, it was killed, and because they wanted to know, they wanted the remains or to nurse it back or whatever they did. But he would do that so often that they got to calling him the Bird Man of Alcosan.
Oh, that's wonderful. That's a great story.
Yes, do you have a question?
There's an interesting opportunity in disaster management. There's a Department of Disaster Management at the University of Pittsburgh, and they have a program in Japan, the 5 years now since the nuclear disaster, the children that lost their homes, of course, and the families that survived have had a time of silence where the shock has been so great that they didn't have any words. And so they have used artists to bring their arts into these communities, and a little bit of fabric murals, talk about fabric design, that has been coming out of that conversation now, has allowed the individuals in Japan to begin to recover their voice and to grieve together and to find community together. And so I'm wondering, as an example like that, we are in climate change and communities are at risk. the issue of feeling safe. Birds need to feel safe, right? Mm-hmm. Better glass windows. But the people are kind of hitting their head against a glass wall, right? Mm-hmm. Glass ceiling that we've heard a particular individual talk about. I mean, we really are a glass ceiling. So the arts, do you see that advancing as a tool of discourse? You know, bringing artists together in communities, not just at showings for openings, to be able to bring out our silent voice of grief so we make that transition. Is that something that is in your radar?
Well, as a gallery owner, I do think that the arts are going to become even more valuable and important, especially as the technologies that we're developing are kind of growing and developing. I think that because although there'll be some jobs through technology that are lost because a robot can do it, whatever, that's not the case with arts. The way that artists approach problems, the way that they use their process to kind of touch on all these things, it really can't be replicated in the way that other certain tasks and things can be replicated. So I think that it will only become more and more important in our, you know, future for artists and arts to kind of bring these things to the forefront. That's my opinion.
I think it's going to grow as well. I did a lot of research prior to starting this 2016 residency because I wanted some context for what other people had been doing. And there's certainly artists, sculptors, 2D artists, musicians that are starting to tackle it. I think it's really going to grow because art historically has always been a voice for discourse. Pick the topic, whatever. I mean, right now, Black Lives Matter, whatever the case may be, you see that represented in the arts, and I think it is going to grow in the visual arts, and it feels somewhat advantageous for me right now that it's sort of in its infancy stages, I might say, in the visual arts, because it's not overcrowded yet, I guess, for those who are trying to find a niche. But I think it's, one, going to be just more abundant, but two, I think also people are going to use it as a means of coping with, I mean, it's terrifying. It's absolutely, it's giving me a stomach ulcer, but yes, so I think it's going to be most, going to continue to grow.
Yes, did you have a question?
Hi. As an artist for a long time, I've kind of grappled with how to use art to raise kind of an awareness of systems or interrelationships or connections, kind of, and of course what you're both doing in terms of patterns is part of that, but I'm thinking even sort of bigger picture in terms of how one thing connects to another, how different disciplines sort of interrelate. That whole idea of, you know, you're talking about visual thinking, right? This sort of systems thinking, how to promote that through art. Have you thought about that? And do you have any ideas about that?
Well, actually, we called this exhibition Emergent Patterns with the idea that the combined effort of all three of these artists are actually creating something together that they didn't even know they could create. So that is the idea, that like through them individually doing their own thing, by coming together to like, you know, do this talk and like talk about how their work relates and these connections, all creates an even bigger kind of experience of importance. So that relates specifically to the exhibit itself. Either of you have something specific about your art, maybe, that you could talk about that connection with?
You know, like you're, for instance, you're kind of trying to image the system of migration or murmuration or whatever, which of course is one sort of system.
Right.
But that's in. Side of a bigger system, bigger, and how to make those bigger connections that we shouldn't just be concerned about birds or just one bird that, you know, that we've lost, but how the birds are important in this larger system, you know, and how it's all interconnected and interdependent. Mm-hmm. Like, how do you get that across?
That's exactly the question I'm asking.
Yeah.
So that is, the bird and the migratory flock and all that, they are characters that kind of tell that story or are asking that exact same question. So that, you know, the whole, you know, pattern of polygons, that could be a census map, you know,
right.
Or it could be, you know, the astral matrix. I mean, it could be, you know, the cells in your body, you know. So I think, and there's so many artists are asking these same questions. So I think that, you know, go to the galleries in Pittsburgh on a given day, you're going to see them. But I, like, you know, when I go to, you know, I try to go to New York a couple times a year to see the galleries, and I'm always amazed at how many artists are asking the same question, and their output is different, which is incredible. But it is that notion of wanting to find connection to one another, right, and connections between disciplines. So I think there's a rich treasure trove of artists like yourself and like us that are asking very similar questions. And I think having access to technology just is making our research and, you know, the art that we make even more rich, and we can, you know, experience each other's work even, I think, much more accessible today. So there's a lot of artists that are doing what we're doing.
And I am very interested in this topic, the broader picture. One, the broader picture, and two, how we're connected with it and all the other pieces, so that nothing feels like it's in isolation, like bird window collisions. But what does that mean in terms of insect populations? And then what does that mean for disease and take Zika? So here we have global temperatures rising, which means that the mosquitoes can go further north, which means we don't have as many birds eating those mosquitoes because they're running into windows. Yes, so certainly it's something I am thinking more and more about, but try not to get too far ahead of myself and be taking like one day at a time. But I also struggle, I really struggle, because I walk this line between fine art and illustration, and they are their own beasts. So I have been trained since an undergrad to think about a client and public perception versus visual artists saying, the hell with you, and I'll do what I want. So I struggle with thinking about those systems. Gets dark for me, mm-hmm. really fast, really dark. Thinking about cancer and how sometimes I sort of think of people as cancer infecting the world. And so I haven't figured out how to represent that in a way that doesn't turn people away, because it's this delicate balance of engaging people, giving them a sense of hope, giving them a way to interpret something that's hard to digest if you're not an analytical linear thinker. I'm certainly not. Without scaring them to death or making it feel divisive. And I don't have an answer to that yet, but I think about it a lot, especially since I've recently been reading about the possibility of soil carbon sequestration as a way to mitigate this methane and carbon emissions in the atmosphere. And I think I read in a book called The Soil Will Save Us that there are more living organisms in one cup of soil than all the creatures that have ever, all the biomass that has ever lived ever in just one cup of soil. So when you think about like the micro and the macro, like that is such great fodder for artwork. I just haven't figured out how to do it yet without making people turn away because it's too much to think about.
My head is near exploding.
Yeah. So I'm just gonna paint warblers until I
figure out how
to do it. I don't know.
But you did promise me pigeons. One of you promised me pigeons.
Oh yes, yes, they are embedded. It's a, you know what, when you go come to the show at Fox Art, and you will see them.
I'm a fan of pigeons.
Me too.
Thank you, everybody, for joining us this evening. We greatly appreciate it. We hope you enjoyed the presentation, and we hope that you will be able to stop by to see their exhibit at the gallery. Thank you. Thanks.
Thank you.